Okay, let's see.
Good morning, Your Honors. May it please the court, Christopher Burke for the trustee. There's three reasons why.
Oh, hold on one second. Let me ask, first of all, do you want to reserve some time, some of your 15 minutes for rebuttal?
3 minutes, please.
3 minutes, okay. Go ahead, please.
Thank you. There's three reasons why the decision of the bankruptcy court should be reversed. First, the Larsons didn't have to file in Nevada. Second, Nevada law requires...
Excuse me one second. We have some background noise. I'm not sure where that's coming from. Could I ask everybody but Mr. Burke to please be sure to mute your microphones? It sounds like there's a jackhammer going in your office, Mr. Burke. I'm not quite sure what that is. Oh, that's okay. We're muted. Try turning your microphone back on. Ah, yeah, it's clearly somewhere on your end in your internet connection. So we'll just have to soldier on. Please go ahead.
Apologize for that. There are three reasons why the bankruptcy court's decision should be reversed. First, the Larsons didn't have to file in Nevada. Second, Nevada law requires somebody to actually reside on property to homestead it. And third, the Nevada Supreme Court wouldn't allow its homestead to extend extraterritorially. That's my first point. Section 1408 allows somebody to file in different states based on where they reside, their domicile, where their principal asset is. The Larsons chose to file in Nevada. Nevada requires one to reside on a property to homestead it. The Larsons have not resided in their home in Washington for at least 6 years. There is no constructive occupancy allowed in Nevada.
Let me ask you a question about the Nelson case. Does the Nelson case deal at all with a situation of a temporary absence from a permanent home?
No, I was involved in that case. It doesn't.
Okay, and isn't this more like it? Well, if you, based on the evidence in the record, isn't this more like a temporary absence case than the facts of Nelson? I mean, Mr. Nelson was never going to go back to that house, right?
Correct. I wouldn't say this is, I don't know if I'd say 6 years is temporary absence. And at the time they were filed, they had a future intent, allegedly, to move back. And for a homestead, I believe you need the intent at the time you filed. It's, so at the time they filed, they were living in Nevada. That was their intent. They did not need the homestead for their livelihood. At times they've rented out that home. And so, even
Mr. Burke, let me just see if I can clarify. You gave us three reasons, and one of the reasons that I thought you were suggesting was they weren't domiciled in Nevada. Is that right?
Yes.
Okay. And clearly, under 522, the domicile of the debtor is critical to the use of exemptions under the statute, right?
Yes.
So if they weren't domiciled in Nevada, your objection is that they can't use Nevada exemptions to exempt this house, right? But they can use...
I would say this.
They can't use a Nevada exemption. Go ahead.
It depends on how you define their domicile. One, they could have filed Nevada or Washington.
Well, wait a second, but the fact that they could file is based on residency. Domicile is necessary for the exemptions to be utilized. They're, according to the opposition they filed to trustees' objection, they were never domiciled anywhere other than Washington. Over the last 6 years, they've spent 3 years in Guam, and they've spent the balance of the period before the filing in Nevada. They've never established a domicile in either location, and they've always asserted that they always were domiciled in Washington. That's what they wrote, that's what they argued, that's what the evidence suggested. You didn't put on any contrary evidence to suggest anything else would be. So they're only domiciles in Washington, correct? By the evidence.
No, in the sense that I did object to the evidence that they put in based on their declaration.
I understand, but you have no evidence that they actually intended to domicile in Nevada. that they are lying about their assertion that their vote in, they vote in Washington, that their driver's licenses are in Washington, that they have bought a house and lived there from 2006 to 2014. They've never claimed another domicile, and you don't have any evidence that they claimed a domicile in any other location, correct?
That is correct, but I
And you can only have one domicile at a time, correct?
Correct.
All right. So, but you can have many residences.
Correct.
And you can move around and still retain the same domicile, even if you don't live there full time, correct?
Correct.
So there's no evidence that there's a Nevada domicile in this case, correct?
No, there's not.
Okay. So Nevada exemptions cannot apply under 525 if you're not domiciled in Nevada, correct?
Under 522A3A, it requires where you domicile, correct?
Right. So if they're only domiciles in Washington, then the only statutes that could be applicable to their exemption claim are Washington statutes, correct?
In general, yes, but here they chose the Nevada exemptions.
So they were wrong. It's not possible to do that. That would violate the statute. The bankruptcy code, the bankruptcy judge would be in error if the bankruptcy court allowed them to apply an exemption that wouldn't be applicable under, correct?
Correct.
All right. But that doesn't preclude them from seeking to utilize, amending their schedules, and seeking to utilize Washington exemptions, does it?
Whether it's too late or not, in general, I know the Michael case allows you to amend at any time. However, I would say after a case has been discharged and the issue argued and gone on appeal, I would file an objection to that.
Yeah, but that's not before us today. The point I'm making is, on the record we have, the bankruptcy court couldn't apply Nevada exemptions on the basis they weren't domiciled in Nevada. And that unfortunately is the way the situation is, undisputed fact, undisputed law, correct?
Correct.
All right. That's what we're stuck with, unfortunately. Your other arguments make little difference, don't they? Because you can't apply a Nevada statute if you're not domiciled in Nevada. Right?
Well, it sounds like you've already decided. I know.
Well, I'm just trying to make sure I understand. I'm trying to understand the effect of the statute and what the facts of this case are and what that would compel us to determine. If you believe that there's something we're missing and you want to, you think that you need to brief it, I don't want to, raise an issue and surprise you and not give you an opportunity, but I don't see how it works. So I'm asking you, you're the professional in the field. You handle all these cases. You make all these objections on behalf of trustees. You've litigated this issue before. How does it work when you are not domiciled in a location and you assert an exemption in that location? Just because you're resident there doesn't mean you can apply the exemption claim, right?
Correct, but I think there's consequences once you choose those exemptions and it's gone this far.
All right, I hear what you're saying.
Okay.
No other questions, I see where you're at, so I don't want to beat a dead horse on it.
Well, you can reserve the rest of your time for rebuttal, perhaps, and after Mr. Neidert speaks.
Thank you.
Okay. Mr. Neidert, go ahead. I guess I wanted to start with a question out of the box, which is not in the record, but the debtors stated their intention to move back to Washington, I think, this past June. Did that actually happen?
Actually, yes, it did. I was actually going to start by pointing out that at the time of the 341 hearing, they presented Washington driver's license that had an address of 1168 Ridgeway Drive in Oak Harbor, Washington, and as their identification for the hearing, and that's exactly where they live now. Since Mr. Larson retired from the Navy, they've actually moved back to Washington State and live at that house in Oak Harbor, Washington.
And I think you know the questions that Judge Gann is going to ask of you, so why don't you take that issue on? How do non-Nevada domiciliaries take any Nevada exemptions.
And, you know, and if that was the error, then perhaps we need to go back and amend our schedule and claim the Washington exemptions. Because clearly, because we're not, we've argued from day one, and can't argue an inconsistent position, that the Larsens are in fact domiciled and have been domiciled in Washington State the entire time. Federal law under the Service Members Relief Act clearly lets them continue their domicile during the entire time Mr. Larsen and his wife were in the United States Navy.
This provision you cited of the SCRA talks about voting rights, right?
Voting rights and also tax rights and everything else. There's another provision that we cited that has to do with tax rights. The SCRA has said voting rights and for tax purposes and whatever, because the tax purpose is why members of the military that live in a state with high state income tax don't have to pay that state income tax while they're in the military. They can go back and say, no, I'm a resident. In this case, the Larsons, I live in Nevada, which has no state income tax, the same benefit, saying I live in Washington. And in fact, that law was amended a couple of years ago to allow spouses to make those same claims now. So yes, the Larsons domicile for military purposes was and has been in Washington State, even while he was stationed in Guam and even when he was stationed at Fallon Naval Air Station in Nevada. So they've now gone back to Washington State in his retirement to be where they said they were going to be. And so, like I said, if we need to amend our schedules to reflect Washington exemptions, I don't see there's a problem doing that. If the trustee had filed an objection saying, wait a second, they should have filed Washington exemptions, we got to do that, we could have done that. The trustee didn't do that. Instead, the trustee chose to specifically target the biggest exemption that anybody has, and that's the residents. So, I mean, if the trustee wants to take the position, well, they should have taken Washington, he could have filed an objection and told us, hey, you need to redo your schedule to reflect Washington law. And we could have gone back, looked through Washington law, figured out how those exemptions applied, and filed the appropriate schedules with the bankruptcy court. It's only now with respect to the domicile, with the residents, they're saying, well, no, you can't do that. No, we're going to object you amending it, because even though they didn't object at first because they were trying to go specifically after that particular property.
Well, that may have been strategically smart, right? Because if he'd won on those arguments, there would be no homestead exemption, if it were not extraterritorial and so forth. If, on the other hand, if you take the line of reasoning that Judge Gann is suggesting, there's at least a Washington homestead exemption. So it's understandable that the trustee took the position he took.
Well, I agree, but I think that it took the position today. Well, we'd object to him amending now. And said if there's an issue with respect to which set of exemptions to claim, we have no problem going back and filing amended schedule to reflect that. That's not the issue that we're trying to protect, obviously, is my client's right to claim a homestead exemption. And I'll acknowledge Washington laws is not as generous, and there actually might be, depending on, there's some valuation issues. Again, that's outside the record. The trustee keeps on saying, well, he did a Zillow value of this and has a value of that, where he disagrees with valuation, but that's all outside the record.
Needs to be done. Mr. Snyder, so the issue for us is the bankruptcy judge allows the Nevada exemption claim, overrules the trustee's objection. If in fact we, based upon an undisputed record that you've suggested exists since the 341 meeting, that the trustee's been aware of, and that there's never been an inconsistent claim made by the debtor, that they've always been domiciled in Washington, then we could reverse the decision of the bankruptcy court with regard to the allowance of the exemption and remand for further proceedings. And at that point, you would have to. And the ruling would simply say, something to the extent that Nevada exemptions can't apply because they're domiciled in Washington. And then you would take whatever next step it is, and the trustee would take whatever next step there is, and then it would either come back to us, or would be resolved, or the bankruptcy court would rule, and there we go, right?
And that might end up being ultimately the way to do it, because as I said, I I will acknowledge we, our schedule showed Nevada exemptions. That perhaps was an error, because we've always said from day one, our position's been from day one, that the Larsons are domiciled in Washington State. So, I mean, so unless there's anything else from the court, I don't think I have much more to say. I think everything else is in our papers.
Okay. All right. Okay. Thank you very much. Mr. Burke, anything you wanted to respond to?
Not unless there's questions.
I don't have any. Anybody on the panel have any more?
No. Okay. I appreciate your efforts. Thank you.
Yes. Thanks to both of you. It's an interesting case and well argued. Appreciate it. The matter is submitted.
Thank you.